Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Creole Rebellion, the most successful slave revolt in American history. By Bruce Chadwick. Narrated by Rick Adamson. Preface. A slave ship in uncharted waters. I stumbled across the story of the slave ship Creole and its mutiny while researching another book. I was immediately transfixed by the sea saga of the 135 people aboard in bondage and how they rose up to take over their ship, killing one man and injuring several others, including the captain, while it sailed down the coast of Florida on its way to New Orleans in the early winter of 1841. The slaves were led by a huge, muscular Virginian, Madison Washington, named after two U.S. presidents, who had been captured while trying to spirit his wife away from his old plantation, from which he had escaped a year earlier. The rebel slaves took control of the Creole after a bloody scuffle and forced the crew to sail to the Bahamas, a group of islands in the Caribbean where African Americans and all people of color were free. The crew knew how to get there, and so did thousands of white mariners who sailed the waters of the Atlantic. But the slaves were headed into uncharted waters, toward islands where their fate, as either mutineers and murderers or as heroes, would be sealed. The tale of the Creole had been overshadowed in history by that of the Amistad, a slave ship that was taken on the high seas by its African prisoners in 1839, and whose case wound up in the United States Supreme Court and was made famous in song, story, and a successful movie. The Creole was just a faint footnote to the drama of the Amistad, but today it is considered the most successful slave revolt in American history. Washington and the 18 men who were directly involved in the mutiny managed not only to take over a large vessel, but also to sail it to the Bahamas, where they were put on trial on charges of mutiny, murder, and seizure of the ship. They were up against the President of the United States himself, John Tyler, and his legendary Secretary of State, Daniel Webster. The fight was so heated that diplomats in the United States and Great Britain, which had jurisdiction over the Bahamas, feared that it would lead to a war. American public officials were pressured heavily by slave-owning Southerners, who feared that the success of the mutineers would lead thousands of other slaves to stage similar revolts and perhaps overturn slavery altogether in the American South. As I plunged into research on the story, the tale assumed great depth because this was not just the drama of a mutiny. A group of prisoners did not just seize a ship and sail off, free men, into the mist. Innumerable questions began to arise. For instance, how did Madison Washington, an enslaved African American whose only known skill was being a cook, stage and carry off a successful armed mutiny? How did he know that the islands of the Bahamas were British territory and that African Americans lived freely there? How did he know that the British courts had freed numerous slaves whose ships had washed ashore in the Bahamas? The mutiny went smoothly, but Washington never thought anyone would be hurt, much less killed. The mutineers' problem now was not just that they had taken a ship, they were also guilty of assault and battery and murder. Would that change the complexion of British justice in the Bahamas? A mutiny was one thing, but a murder was something else. And as I followed the story, I wondered, as many people in that era did, what exactly was the legal definition of murder? Was the killing of slave trader John Hewell on board the ship premeditated? Was it self-defense because Hewell was armed? Was Hewell just an accidental victim of a fight on the ship? Was Hewell's death murder under American law because the Creole was an American-owned ship, or was it not? Was it murder under British law because the murderers surrendered themselves in Nassau and admitted that a man had been killed? Could a Nassau court try American citizens? What about murder on the high seas? Was it different than murder on land? In whose jurisdiction was it? Or, since the ship traveled through international waters, was it a murder that could not be adjudicated by anyone? I also explore the intricate slave trade up and down the eastern seaboard in the period between 1820 and 1842, shedding new light on why it was instituted and how it worked. Why were thousands of slaves, including Washington and the other prisoners aboard the Creole, taken from Richmond, Virginia, south along the coast, around the tip of Florida, and on to New Orleans? It was because Virginia had too many slaves and Louisiana too few. The solution seemed simple to slavers back then. Haul the slaves from Virginia, where they were not needed, down to New Orleans, where they would be sold to planters in Louisiana who did need them. And speaking of slaves, what about the 116 slaves not charged with any crimes who were released in Nassau? There is evidence that some boarded ships to Jamaica, others boarded ships for other islands in the Caribbean, or moved to other islands in the Bahamas. Not one remained in Nassau to await the outcome of the mutiny trial of their fellow passengers. Why? Did they lack confidence in British justice? American justice? Did every one of them believe the American sailors' talk that the U.S. Navy would arrive, capture them, and put them back into slavery in the United States? And why did none of those 116 people help the 19 men who staged the mutiny? Well, they were scared. The penalty for participating in a mutiny is usually death. Slave mutineers on other ships in the Caribbean and on the oceans had been executed for taking part in a mutiny. The non-participating slaves on the Creole probably reasoned that if they refused to join the mutiny and it failed, they would not be legally responsible. They may have reasoned, too, that if the mutiny succeeded, they could gain freedom without taking any risk. If someone else was willing to carry off the mutiny, well, let them. The search for the Creole story led me to a distinguished, admirable, and hardy British governor, Francis Cockburn, a veteran administrator who had worked for the British for years in Canada and enjoyed his work in the Bahamas as its governor. Cockburn had one big skeleton in his diplomatic closet, though, his older brother, Sir George Cockburn. Americans remembered that he was the British admiral who, during the War of 1812, had burned the White House and U.S. Capitol, as well as some other governmental buildings, infuriating not only Americans, but also his British superiors back home. Francis Cockburn saw his decision as very simple, and at the same time, very complex. Slaves who landed on his islands, no matter how they arrived, were free under British law. This was the case with three recent ships, the Comet, 1830, Hermosa, 1840, and Encomium, 1831, that had not experienced mutinies but had simply foundered at sea and washed up close to shore. Slaves fled these ships and found safety on shore. Cockburn oversaw the freedom of the slaves aboard the Hermosa during his time as governor. With the Creole, though, he had a murder to deal with. Should he free the killers on the dock when they arrived, put them on trial for murder in Nassau, or send them to England for justice? And what was the British governor to do with the Creole itself? Did he have to tell its crew to sail on to New Orleans, or was the ship somehow now an impounded British vessel since it was anchored in a British harbor and was also the scene of a murder? What about battered Captain Robert Ensor? What was British or American law concerning him and all other sea captains in that terribly unique situation? He now had no ship, just wounds. What would happen to Ensor when he returned to the United States? And what of American reaction, which was swift, harsh, and well-publicized? If the British governor took a misstep, would the U.S. Navy invade the Bahamas and start shelling the town of Nassau in an effort to get the slaves back? Slave owners in the United States were terrified of slave revolts, The United States had experienced a number of them over the years, including the Stono Rebellion in 1739, one led by Gabriel Prosser in Richmond, Virginia in 1800, one led by Denmark Vesey in 1822, and the revolt led by Nat Turner in 1831. Here was another, and it involved not only 135 slaves who fled to freedom, but also the British government and its anti-slavery policies. The Southern states pressured Tyler and his savvy Secretary of State Webster to get the ship and all the slaves back. They were the property of their owners, not freedmen, and certainly not freedmen who now believe they were British citizens, no less. At the same time, many Northerners wanted the slaves to be free, but also wanted Tyler to stand up to the British. Who were they to seize an American ship and its slaves? This seizure of men at sea was the same thing that had caused a war in 1812. Cannons had answered their impressment of American sailors then, and should answer it once again, some thought. The pressure on Tyler was enormous. And what about Tyler? He was the accidental president because he was the first president to take office upon the death of a former chief executive. In office just a few months, and already battered by politicians in Washington, he now faced the Creole crisis, which could either sink his presidency or, he knew, make his presidency a great success. The Creole story also involved three of the most important political figures in early American history: John Quincy Adams, Henry Clay, and Daniel Webster. The three would battle each other, and at times President Tyler, to solve the mutiny ship's puzzle, legally, morally, and politically. The bombastic Adams was the sixth president of the United States and the son of the second president, John Adams. He was a staunch abolitionist and had plenty of friends for that anti-slavery stand and plenty of enemies, too. Webster, who uttered so many memorable quotes, "Liberty and Union, now and forever, one and inseparable," was a former Massachusetts senator and Secretary of State for William H. Harrison and then John Tyler. He had an enormous reputation, power, and influence. Last but certainly not least was Henry Clay of Kentucky, a charismatic senator at the time of the mutiny and a former congressman who had been elected Speaker of the House at the tender age of 29. Clay was the great puppeteer of the Senate, using his many political skills and a lot of arm twisting to get his way on issues. He also desperately wanted to be president and would come within a handful of votes for the prize in three different elections. The three would pull out their political swords and duel over the Creole and its slave mutineers, and duel with the British too. The dispute would change American politics. And what of the abolitionists, those intrepid anti-slavery champions who wanted the peculiar institution abolished? They had won a great victory with the Supreme Court decision in the Amistad trial, but the slaves on the Amistad were Africans. The slaves on the Creole, though, were Americans, all born and raised in the United States. They were far, far better symbols of slavery than the Amistad captives, who did not even speak English. The abolitionists hoped that the Creole incident would help their case and make their ranks grow. They needed something because the movement had landed on hard times. The number of abolitionists was dwindling. Their support had stagnated. Their funds had just about run out. They had much trouble gaining newspaper attention, and their new abolitionist journals, except for the Liberator, had foundered. The abolitionist senators and congressmen were few, too, and never enough to get anti-slavery bills passed. They knew the Creole dispute might change all that. And what about the British, seen as haughty bullies by most Americans who still felt the wounds of both the War of 1812 and the American Revolution? Were these not the dogs, most Americans believed, who not only killed more than 10,000 American soldiers in the Revolution, but burned the White House in the War of 1812? Burned the White House. How could Tyler and Webster deal with them? Their anti-slavery laws, which had been passed by Parliament from 1807 through 1833, seemed to protect the slaves from the Creole. The U.S. government, led by Tyler and Webster, had to get around those laws somehow, some way. Could they? Should they? And finally, there was Texas. James K. Polk received and deserved much of the credit for getting the Lone Star Republic annexed as a U.S. state, but it was John Tyler who started the annexation process. Why did he do it, starting just after he took over the White House following President Harrison's funeral? Was it just because he saw Texas joining the Union as a way to get elected president in 1844, riding into the White House on a wave of Texas elation, especially in slave states? Or was there something else? Was there a feeling on Tyler's part that the United States would be incomplete without Texas? You could say that this is yet another book about slavery, but it's not. You could say it's yet another book about high seas adventures, but it's not. You could say that this is a book about a man's undaunted desire to be with his wife, but it's not. You could say that this is yet another book about politics, but it's not. No. This is a book about a great nation, the United States, that came face to face with a dark, ugly issue that was and still is tearing it up. Slavery on the waters of the Atlantic Ocean in 1841 and won and lost. It is also a book about 135 enslaved men and women in chains who, unwilling to take their oppression any longer, rose up and freed themselves in a bloody fight. It is a theme heralded in American streets recently under the flags of Black Lives Matter and other social justice movements. It is a theme, too, that others will march for in the future, again and again, until the United States becomes the nation Madison Washington and his mutineers dreamed about on the high seas so long ago. Chapter 1. Cruising Down the Atlantic Coast. November 7, 1841. On board the Creole, Atlantic Ocean. 130 miles northeast of the Bahamas, 9 p.m. Enslaved bondsman Madison Washington, age 25, was a huge man who towered over just about everybody. He had thick arms, thick legs, a large head, a strong torso, and a barrel chest. He was of manly form, tall, symmetrical, round, and strong. In his movements, he seemed to combine a lion's elasticity. His torn sleeves disclosed arms like polished iron. He had Herculean strength, wrote one observer. Another said he had high integrity and intelligence and was determined to succeed at whatever he did, and a third called him one of the handsomest of his race. In addition to his physical size, he had numerous leadership skills, all hinted at in the way he carried himself. People followed him, one newspaper editor wrote, because of his commanding attitude and daring orders when he stood a freeman on the slaver's deck. Washington leaned against a thick wooden pillar in the darkened hold of the Creole, a slave ship carrying him and 134 other enslaved men and women from northern Virginia, where they had worked at plantations and factories, to a busy slave market in New Orleans. There, they would all be sold to the highest bidder or delivered to men who had already purchased them from agents. Washington did not want to go to New Orleans. He wanted freedom. He had been a free man for a year, living in a free black community in Canada, where slavery had been outlawed, and enjoying all the benefits of freedom. He had given up that life to return to America to stage a daring raid to free his wife at the Virginia plantation where she was enslaved. The attempt failed. His big body moved from side to side as the Creole, a 157-ton two-masted brig with two large square sails that billowed in the breeze, plus a trysail at the rear and a jib in front, moved south. The ship was just a year old, owned by the Johnson and Epperson Company of Richmond. It slid gently through the quiet waters of the Atlantic on its voyage off the coast of Florida to New Orleans. Brigs such as this, designed by the Navy for warfare in the Mediterranean in the early 1800s, later became popular cargo ships. They had large, wide, and deep holds that could carry tons of tobacco, hemp, flax, corn, and other merchandise. Smaller than most ships, they could move in and out of harbors, large and small, with ease. The Navy and merchant shippers built a second wave of brigs in the late 1830s. Ironically, one of the best was the Washington, a naval vessel that was in service when the Creoles sailed off Florida with Madison Washington. Many such ships were built with forced labor, as Washington and the others knew. Shipping merchants engaged in the very profitable slave trade found the brigs to be the best possible ships to transport African Americans up and down the East Coast. The brigs had large open holds that could serve as simple quarters for substantial numbers of slaves, generally apportioned at one slave per ton of ship's weight. The captives required nothing more than a floor and a blanket for sleeping. Brigs easily accommodated deckside cooking pots to feed slaves. The hatches and deck doors on brigs led African Americans down wooden stairs to their quarters in the hold. Some brigs, including the Creole, painted black with a white ring around the top perimeter of its hull, could be sectioned off so that part of the hold carried slaves and another part cargo. On the Creole, tobacco was packed into the middle of the hold and exuded a sweet smell. The Creole's voyage, with its interior full of slaves, was routine. Many slave ships had made the trip down the Floridian coast before it, and many more would do so in the next 20 years. What the slave traders did not realize, though, was that the same hatches that permitted crews to go in and out of the hold to check on cargo also permitted African Americans to run out of the same hold rapidly during any attack on the ship, which is exactly what happened on the Creole on that still November night. A crew of just a few mates and six men ran the ship under Captain Robert Enser, who was, at the time of the mutiny, in the captain's quarters with his wife, 4-year-old daughter, and niece, age 15, whom he had brought along so they could take a vacation with him when the ship docked. New Orleans was a colorful and exciting city, jammed with visitors who meandered up and down its noisy streets at night and populated its enormous shopping emporiums in the daytime. Ships from all over the world traveled to the Crescent City. It was flooded with fine restaurants, bars, clubs, and theaters. One could find music from the Caribbean, South America, and Central America in the clubs there, played loudly by pianists in saloons. The lanterns that lit the city looked like long strings of fireflies in the night. The clubs were generally open until the wee hours of the morning. Captain Enser had visited the city several times and wanted his family to see the sights there. Brassy and bold New Orleans had become one of the world's most fabled cities, a magnet for travelers from around the globe. Very few ship's masters brought their families with them on slave transports because the cargo holds were full of produce and African Americans. Captains usually did not like to subject their loved ones to several weeks of travel on the oceans, which were subject to turbulent weather conditions and sometimes fatal sinkings. And there was always the possibility, although small, of a slave uprising on board the vessel. But Captain Enser had no worries about any of those problems, as he talked quietly with his wife in his quarters that night. This was just another voyage of a ship carrying a large number of captive African Americans. The weather had been good, the seas relatively calm, and the crew hardworking. His wife, daughter, and niece had been successful at entertaining each other over the nearly 2 weeks of travel, so that social problem had been solved rather easily. They were sailing several miles off the coast of the United States and had seen no other ships on their voyage. Another reason Enser had invited his family to join him on the trip, such an unusual practice on slave transports, was because he did not expect any trouble from his captives, even though they were unhappy about their relocation to New Orleans. Slaves were always unhappy. Ensor thought little of the recent Supreme Court decision that upheld a lower court ruling that the captives on board the slave ship Amistad, traveling through the Caribbean in 1839 in international waters, were free men and could not be incarcerated in America for their role in a shipboard mutiny that resulted in the deaths of several crewmen. This was the only slave insurrection at sea that Ensor had ever heard about, and it did not bother him at all. His ship was different. His crew was different. His slaves were different. They were Americans. The Amistad captives had been foreigners. Ensor did not connect the Amistad to the Creole. To him, the Amistad seizure was an isolated incident. Other captives involved in the slave trade did care, though. They were always worried about something. Most of all, they feared slave rebellions. To take control, enslaved men and women on ships had far less territory to conquer than those on a plantation, and they had easy access to ship tools that could be used as weapons. Oppressively hot weather on the sea was just as uncomfortable as weather on land, but on a ship, there was nowhere to go for breezes when you were kept prisoner in a steamy, hot hold. Tensions grew in hot weather, so ship's captains used a great deal of caution with their captives. During the daytime, they routinely chained the hands and/or feet of the slaves, and at night fastened those chains to the floor of the hold to prevent any possibility of a mutiny. Doors and hatches to the hold were locked tight, and armed guards were posted in front of them. Ensor was not like the other captains. He was so certain that the enslaved men and women would not trouble him that he decided not to restrain them at all. They moved freely about the hold, the men on one end and the women on the other, separated by a large wall made of the thousands of pounds of bundled tobacco the vessel was carrying to the Crescent City. He knew all about the harsh conditions on slave ships that carried Africans across 3,000 miles of water in the Atlantic from Africa to America, but those men and women were foreigners, angry about their capture and unable to speak English. The slaves on the Creole had been born in America, spoke English, and posed far less threat of trouble than the Africans. He had no fears, but he should have known that letting his captives roam the ship unbound increased the chances for a rebellion. November 7th was the 11th day of the voyage down the coast, and there had been no hint of trouble. The Creole, its sails full of wind and its wooden beams creaking as it sailed through the waves, was making good time. All was well. The ship was more than halfway to New Orleans. The voyage was routine, and much like the more than 100 other slave transport trips made from southern cities to New Orleans, the Amistad mutiny was far from Captain Ensor's mind. On deck that night, it was dark except for a single lantern that hung near the wheel so that the man sailing the ship, the first mate, could see. It was quiet. Waves lapped gently against the side of the ship, which rolled easily in the water. A gentle breeze drifted through the night and was caught by the large sails of the vessel, helping it to travel southward and stay on schedule. The ship creaked a bit as it moved gently through the water. Washington, the leader, had spent the previous 10 days privately organizing a large-scale insurrection on board the slave ship. He hoped it would result in a quick and bloodless takeover of the vessel and freedom for all. When the ship was his, he planned to order the captain, at gunpoint, to sail the Creole to the nearby Bahamas, where slavery had ended in 1833. There, he and the rest of the slaves would disembark, never to return to the United States. They would be free people, free from everybody. "The fundamental principles of the Republic are inapplicable to us," wrote Frederick Douglass later about slave insurrectionists at sea and in international waters. They lived in a no man's land, separated from everybody. Slaves at sea were neither criminals nor citizens. historian James Kettner agreed. The plan to sail to an island in the Bahamas was a good one, because over the previous few years, the British government there had freed all the enslaved men and women who had arrived there after shipwrecks. Abolitionist William Wells Brown shrugged his shoulders later when he heard about the Creole mutiny. The slaves were, of course, free as soon as they stepped foot on British soil. Thus were 134 persons made free by the intrepidity of one slave, Washington, he wrote. The Bahamas was probably the best port Washington could have chosen. The tropical island chain, which enjoyed pleasant weather all year and sported elegant palm tree-lined beaches, had a long history of cordiality to freed and runaway slaves. It was one of the many islands in the Caribbean taken by the Spanish in 1782 during the American Revolution. When that war ended, fearing retribution, thousands of British loyalists fled the United States. Most headed for Canada, but thousands, mostly southern slaveholders, went to the Bahamas or Bermuda after pleading with the British for help. The Crown established and armed a joint British loyalist army that attacked and captured the islands in 1783 after a short battle. More than 7,000 loyalists took part in the invasion. Loyalists from slave states such as North and South Carolina did not sell or free their African Americans back home at the end of the war. They brought them to the islands and started farming. Then they began importing more slaves from Africa to establish cotton plantations. Within a few years, the island population tripled, mostly through the arrival of slaves in bondage. American planters stopped importing slaves to the Bahamas in 1807, when England passed the first in a series of laws designed to eliminate the ocean slave trade. In 1818, the Crown ruled that any African American who arrived in the Bahamas by any means was automatically free. In 1833, an Act of Parliament freed all slaves in the British Empire and all its Caribbean possessions. The Bahamas became a mecca for slaves yearning to be free. In the 1820s, hundreds of imported Africans living in Florida, plus hundreds of enslaved Seminole Indians, fled their plantations. As part of the complex escape plot, black Bahamians sailed to the coast of Florida in 27 large schooners loaded with clothing and food. The Bahamians and the slaves they rescued braved treacherous storms, rough waters, and oppressive heat to make the unprecedented journey across the ocean to the island chain. They landed on lightly populated Andros Island. It was far from the capital of the Bahamas, bustling Nassau, and they established a free colony there and thrived. Later, in the 1830s and 1840s, Nassau became a stop on American slave trade routes from southern ports down the Florida coast to New Orleans. Several vessels were wrecked in storms. The Hermosa was one of those ships, as were the Comet and the Encomium. They all found help in the Bahamas, and the African Americans on them all found freedom. There was a dual purpose to the British policy. First and foremost, it was a humanitarian effort to end slavery. There was a second motive, though, and that was to strengthen ties between the all-powerful and all-white British government with the primarily all-black population. Freeing blacks from slavery made white British leaders very popular with black Bahamians and Bermudians, whom they ruled. And that made all government, social, and cultural relationships between the residents of the islands much better. The Bahamas also had about 6,000 newly arrived Africans freed from foreign slave ships the British Navy had stopped at sea after implementation of the 1807 law. None of the slave ships risked a sea battle with the heavily armed warships. The Crown needed a central place to put the newly freed slaves, and it chose the warm-weather Bahamas, where freed slaves already lived. In 1834 alone, the British liberated 900 Africans discovered on Spanish ships near Cuba and took them to the Bahamas and freedom. This infusion of newly free people from Africa gave the islands a large free black population. Some of the freed Africans joined the Bahamian army, others worked in shops in brightly painted buildings, and others labored on farms. Their children and grandchildren grew up as free men and women. Some of them established plantations or went into the fishing business. Some Nassau residents visited the freed men and freed women on Andros and helped them to assimilate and to move to Nassau. By the time the Creole sailed into the waters of the Bahamas, the blacks there had enjoyed freedom for nearly a decade and were eager to help any African Americans who arrived on their islands. There were approximately 13,000 free blacks in the Nassau area and just 3,000 or 4,000 whites. The Crown employed 500 soldiers, almost all of them black. British officials, badly outnumbered, were eager to maintain good relations with the residents. The black residents were overjoyed to see new and freed faces in their midst. The newly freed men and women reflected their own dreams about the elimination of slavery. These dreams were not only coming true, but were being made true by the navy and army of a major world power, the British. Their success over the previous few decades in freeing thousands of slaves on ships at sea might encourage other nations, even the United States, to do the same thing. So the Bahamian blacks not only welcomed runaways, but also cheered them on. Madison Washington thought about the Bahamas as he waited in the hold. The giant slave needed to succeed in his plan of mutiny because rebels who tried to gain control of slave ships were always executed, often right on the deck of the boat. In 1829, 197 slaves held in bondage aboard another slave transport sailing down the Atlantic coast, the Lafayette, had attempted a mutiny too. The crew put it down after a violent encounter on deck. There was an aborted revolt on another ship, the Ajax, right after that. In 1844, following a failed mutiny on the slave ship Kentucky, 45 male slaves and one woman involved in a failed takeover were hanged from the yardarm of their ship. The captain then lowered their dead bodies to the deck and had crewmen shoot each in the chest as a show to the remaining slaves on board. The bodies were then dumped into the ocean. Washington had to know, too, that while there had been successful mutinies, the overwhelming majority had failed, and that many of their leaders and participants had been killed in the fight to grab control of the vessel. A good example was a failed revolt on a ship out of Newport, Rhode Island, commanded by Captain T. Rogers in 1758. He led his crew in a pitched battle against slave mutineers who tried to seize the ship on the high seas. In the skirmish, 11 Africans were killed, 13 jumped overboard to their deaths, and several were wounded by pistol and rifle fire. Revolts on land also met with harsh opposition and severe punishment. Southern reaction to Nat Turner's revolt in 1831 was swift. After the revolt, Harriet Jacobs, an enslaved woman living in Edenton, North Carolina, wrote that news of Turner's rebellion threw our town into great commotion, and that she was surprised that whites were so perturbed by blacks, whom they always claimed were happy bondsmen and bondswomen. Strange that they should be so alarmed when their slaves were so contented and happy, she commented. Jacobs added that whites roamed through the town and nearby plantations, looking for any evidence of local plots, and punished any slaves they could find for Turner's actions. Everywhere, men, women, and children were whipped until the blood stood in puddles at their feet, she said. Many African Americans did not rise up, but revolted on plantations by acts of arson, poisoning, and work slowdowns. The Liberator reported that a 10-year-old girl in Georgia accused of arson was tied to a tree and burned to death. Whites closely monitored areas of the South that were well known for slave resistance. One of them was the area of northern Virginia where Madison Washington resided. That's where the notorious rebel Gabriel Prosser launched his failed 1802 revolt. Black leader Robert Purvis acknowledged Prosser's work in his writings. Slave populations would continue to raise up Gabriels and Nats, he wrote, and that included Richmond and Northern Virginia, where Madison Washington had been held in bondage. Slaveholders in New Orleans, where the Creole was headed, fretted over the shipboard mutinies. They said slaves involved in them were criminals and agitators whom the Virginians wanted to get rid of, therefore sending them to Louisiana and elsewhere in New Orleans. This was, said the editor of the New Orleans Courier, among many of the evil consequences attendant upon the system followed by our northern neighbors of sending the most worthless and abandoned portion of their population to this place. Slave revolts troubled Southerners because they worked. World history is full of them. Small-scale revolts on farms in various countries in different centuries often resulted in freedom for a family or a small number of slaves who fled following the uprising. Larger revolts, such as one in ancient Troy, often succeeded as well. Several revolts freed slaves in different parts of the Roman Empire. One of the largest, led by Spartacus, nearly toppled the empire itself. Slave owners and local pro-slavery farmers did not know how to assess the attitude of their slaves. Should they worry about the quiet ones or the angry ones? Planters constantly talked about irritated slaves and their troublesome nature, which they saw as a perpetual threat. There is scarce a day passes without some robbery or insolence committed by them in part or other of this province, complained James Wright, governor of the colony of Georgia, as early as 1774. Madison Washington had no fear of dying. He was dead already, he believed. He had escaped from his Virginia plantation a year earlier, but was unable to free his wife, Susan. Moving about stealthily and traveling at night, he made it to Canada, where he lived for a year with white abolitionist Hiram Wilson at a freed slave colony in Dawn, a village near Toronto. There, he became friendly with other abolitionists, such as Joseph John Gurney from Great Britain. Part of the British Empire, Canada had outlawed slavery too, and slave catchers could not touch slaves there. Washington was safe, and would have stayed there, safe and free, if he had not missed his wife so desperately. He saved his money and sneaked back to Virginia to rescue his wife and bring her back to Canada with him. His plan backfired, and he was captured. A few weeks later, he was sold to Thomas McCargo, a slave agent in Richmond, who routinely took slaves to New Orleans for resale. He put Washington in a slave pen in Richmond. A few days later, he added him to a slave gang and led them all to the dock area of the Virginia capital, where they were ushered up the gangway of a vessel. They were headed for Louisiana. That region desperately needed slaves for its booming sugar plantations, and Virginia had too many of them. So Virginians were eager to sell excess slaves, dispatch troublemakers like Washington, and even ban former slaves who had won their freedom from the state. Washington never expected to be put on a slave ship. He knew that if the ship made it to New Orleans and he was sold to an owner of a sugar plantation, he would never see his wife again. So he knew he had to take the ship on the high seas and be free. Washington also knew that plantation insurrection leaders had been hanged too. They might not have been successful, but they rattled the slaveocracy of the South. Most Americans knew of the rebellions of Denmark Vesey, Gabriel Prosser, and Nat Turner. Numerous people had been killed in Turner's rebellion. During his abortive rebellion in Richmond, Prosser had planned to kidnap Virginia Governor James Monroe, a future president, and hold him hostage. Washington was aware of dozens of other rebellions that had been put down brutally or discovered and crushed in their planning stages. The Creole slaves knew, too, that the severe retaliation against slaves all over the South because of Nat Turner did not deter others from planning takeovers, even if they failed. The Turner retaliation had been quick and massive. Following it, the editor of the Messenger of Macon, Georgia, described dismay and terror in people of all ages and sizes. Vigilante committees and regulators in different states murdered blacks they suspected of planning rebellions like Turner's. One group of slaves was tied to a cluster of trees, admonished for the Turner uprising, and then hacked to death by men with long swords. People in New Orleans were gripped by rumors of security forces that had brought in weapons to put down any slave uprising. The fear of more uprisings was so great in Southampton County, Virginia, where Turner lived, that a security force of more than 1,000 armed white men was raised. In Madison County, Mississippi, in June 1835, a number of slaves were determined to rise up against their owner, Rule Blake, and kill him. They would be aided by several white men in the area. The plot failed, and local authorities hanged 15 slaves and 6 white men. That same summer and fall, failed slave uprising plots were reported in Georgia, South Carolina, North Carolina, Virginia, Alabama, Louisiana, and Texas. People in Charlestown, Maryland, were certain that a rebellion was about to begin. A newspaper reported, "The community was guarded every night by respectable white men." That autumn, white agitators who had tried to help slaves rebel were hanged in Lynchburg, Virginia, Lumpkin County, Georgia, Aiken, South Carolina, and Jefferson County, Georgia. Many blacks connected to those rebellions were killed, too. In other southern counties, cities, and villages, residents panicked over every rumor of a slave uprising. Southerners feared blacks because it was easy for them to get real weapons or to turn hoes and rakes into weapons. Slaves also had vast information-gathering networks, and news flew easily from plantation to plantation. The biggest reason for worry, though, was that there were so many slaves. Some states had nearly as many slaves as white citizens. In Mississippi in 1835, for example, slaves represented 39.6% of the state's population. As the years went by, the percentage of slaves grew higher in all southern states. Whites went to sleep worrying about what that army of blacks was preparing to do to them. As early as 1713, Virginia's chief executive, William Gooch, had written that just a few troublemaker slaves could bring about a mass insurrection. And in case there should arise a man of desperate courage amongst us, exasperated by a desperate fortune, he might, with more advantage than Catiline, kindle a servile war. Such a man might be dreadfully mischievous before any opposition could be formed against him, and tinge our rivers wide as they are with blood. A contemporary, Colonel William Byrd, had agreed with Gooch, deploring the rising number of blacks in Virginia. He told friends that blacks not only dominated the workforce, but also destroyed white residents' desire to work. Many prominent Americans, including future President Thomas Jefferson, said that slaves felt they had to revolt, and probably should. This was the theme of the anti-slavery abolitionists. The words of Jefferson on slave revolts echoed through the valleys of Virginia, other southern states, and the decks of slave ships. "And can the liberties of a nation be thought secure when we have removed their only firm basis, a conviction in the minds of the people that these liberties are the gift of God, that they are not to be violated without His wrath? I tremble for my country when I reflect that God is just, that His justice cannot sleep forever." In small enclaves of the South, planters also trembled when they read the writings of John Parrish and others. Parrish wrote that during the previous few decades, crops had been infested by weevils and worms, and the growing season had been curtailed by endless rain because of an angry God. Parrish and others also argued that the nation was not going to stay half slave and half free. A house divided against itself cannot stand, neither can a government or a constitution, he said, taking lines from the Bible in language repeated with more thunder by Abraham Lincoln in 1858. Others, such as Luther Martin, had suggested that there would be a terrible price to pay for slavery in America. National crimes can only be, and frequently are, punished in this world by national punishments, he warned. For decades, long before Denmark Vesey, some had preached for violent slave revolts. And so all the black men now in our plantations who are by unjust force deprived of their liberty and held in slavery, as they have none upon earth to appeal to, may lawfully repel that force with force, and to recover their liberty destroy their oppressors, wrote a pamphleteer in 1760. In 1816, a pamphleteer wrote that no human law must be obeyed when it contravenes the divine command, but slavery is the combination of all iniquity, and therefore every man is obligated not to participate in its corruption. A man in Darien, Georgia, wrote that it was upsetting to human nature that any race of mankind should be sentenced to perpetual slavery, nor in justice can we think otherwise of it, that they are thrown amongst us to be our scourge one day and another day our sins. And as freedom to them must be as dear as to us, what a sense of horror must it bring about. The anti-slavery speeches and writings of Jefferson and others in Virginia had been made at the turn of the century. By 1820, when the Missouri Compromise was being argued in Congress, Virginia's leaders had set aside the anti-slavery trumpet and warmly embraced slavery. 40 years had passed since the end of the Revolution. Eli Whitney had invented the cotton gin, making farming more profitable, increasing production by a factor of 300 times with slave labor. Southerners were making a fortune off cotton and their bondsmen and women slaves. Why abandon the system? Madison Washington shook his head from side to side whenever he thought about the plantation slave system, more determined than ever to flee. A slave revolution? Many, North and South, had advocated that. They all said that once a small band of slaves had successfully taken a village, millions of other slaves would rise up, obtain arms, and overthrow the governments in each slave state. The idea gained strength in the early 1800s when armed slaves overthrew the government of Haiti and defeated a large French army in the process. The army was not beaten by armed slaves, though. It was beaten by illness. Almost 26,000 French soldiers in Haiti died of yellow fever. Numerous Haitian slaves later moved to Virginia and told that heroic story often. Washington, who was captive on a plantation near Richmond, where many Haitians had settled, probably heard the story, but he and others realized that such a revolt could not happen in Virginia. None of the militias in that state would be incapacitated by disease, since these soldiers had grown up in the state and were likely immune to any epidemic. A rebellion would not work. The one major effort, led by Prosser in 1802, had failed, and its leaders were all hanged. The bill that ended the slave trade, passed in 1807, had accomplished little good. The total number of slave ships violating the ban was unknown, but dozens were captured in different waters. In Pensacola, Florida, in 1818, soldiers under General Andrew Jackson captured 3 slave transports. These captures spurred President James Monroe to sign a bill that permitted payments to slave smugglers who turned in their employers. Monroe also dispatched a small fleet of U.S. Navy warships to intercept slave ships off the coast of West Africa. In the late 1830s, President Martin Van Buren sent another fleet of ships to West Africa to stop slave traffickers. The fleet was successful and brought back captured slavers. Some of the slaves on seized ships were freed or escaped when the vessels docked in American ports. In most of these cases, though, the owners of the ships were foreigners and could not be prosecuted, so the ships were seized, but the owners were let go. Some cities, such as New York, were lenient on captured slavers. Others, such as Baltimore, were harsh. In some cases, a judge confiscated one of an owner's ships and let the other go. Some slavers sued the United States in those instances. All this made naval captains reluctant to do anything. Many simply anchored at an island off the coast of Africa and did nothing, regularly sending home reports that they had found no transgressors in that part of the ocean. The U.S. Navy seized an average of just two or three ships each year in the 1840s. Politics was involved, too. Slavers knew there were bad relations between the United States and Britain, and that the United States fiercely opposed the crew of any English ship boarding an American vessel looking for deserters from the British Navy. Worried that in that effort the British would find their slaves, slave ships simply brought down their own flags, no matter what nationality, and hoisted an American flag to prevent seizure by British ships. Any British captain who righteously seized a slave ship flying an American flag found himself mired in the middle of controversy and castigated by American diplomats, even though he was in fact right to seize the ship. Such an action would seem to want nothing to give it the character of a most flagrant and daring outrage, and very little to sink it into an act of open and direct piracy, argued Andrew Stevenson, U.S. Minister to London, concerning the Spanish ship Mary, which had struck its American flag when it observed a British cruiser approaching. The illegal slave trade flourished in direct proportion to the increasing need for slaves in the southern states as the cotton industry boomed. The success of cotton spurred farmers in other states and territories, such as Texas, to grow it too, and to use new seaports such as Galveston to get the cotton to European markets. Dozens of slave ships traveled from Africa to Brazil and the southern U.S. states, their holds loaded with thousands of slaves. As long as they kept away from sea traffic on the Atlantic or continued to switch flags, they were able to avoid being stopped and, if discovered to be slave ships, sailed into northern U.S. ports. Their captains, often paid 10 times the normal merchant captain's pay, were successful at evading detection most of the time. Most nations that permitted slavery simply ignored U.S. efforts to stop it on the high seas or in foreign ports. In 1845, Henry Wise, U.S. Minister to Brazil, tried to get the Brazilian government to seize U.S. slave ships entering its waters and failed. Exasperated, he wrote the State Department, "I beseech, I implore the President to take a decided stand on this subject. You have no idea of the effrontery and the flagrant outrages of the African slave trade and of the shameless manner in which its worst crimes are licensed here. Every patriot would blush for our country did he know and see how our citizens sail and sell our flag to the uses and abuses of that accursed traffic." The State Department's response to his fervent plea? Wise was reprimanded for exceeding his instructions. Ironically, the very political Wise became a pro-slavery governor of Virginia in the late 1850s and was the executive who signed John Brown's death certificate after his Harper's Ferry raid in 1859. The only resolution Washington could think about was mutiny. The knowledge of uprisings made it easier for him to recruit men on board to seize the slave ship. He had convinced the slaves that takeovers were easier on sea than on land, and that the unshackled slaves had enough freedom to serve as an unstoppable force. The men on the Creole believed that, despite the odds, they just might succeed. They were not chained, were overseen by a very small crew, and had, in Madison, Washington, a strong leader. As the balmy night of November 7th continued on the Creole, Washington, in the darkness of the hold, made fists with his hands again and again, and whispered to the 18 men he had recruited for the takeover. He kept thinking about his plan. If everything worked, it would get him and the other slaves out of the United States and to some safe haven, hopefully in either British-occupied Bermuda or the Bahamas, where Great Britain would, he hoped, accord him and his fellow slaves legal protection. However, they had sailed well past Bermuda by that time, so the target now had to be the Bahamas. He had met American abolitionists when he was free and discussed his plan to return to Virginia to rescue his wife. They opposed it, warning him that in a journey that long, he might be captured and tossed back into slavery. He did not pay attention. Among the things he learned from them and remembered was that if a slave ship was liberated on the high seas or in the territorial waters of another country, the slaves were usually ruled free. He knew of the Hermosa case. He had probably heard of the 1772 case of the Somerset, in which a slave who had lived in England as a freeman was captured on a ship in the Caribbean, pressed back into slavery, and then freed by British courts. And from Underground Railroad leaders, he likely heard that British ships that captured slave transports had been freeing the slaves and sending them to the Bahamas. Most of all, he learned all about the 1839 Amistad Mutiny. He visited abolitionist Robert Purvis, who had just received a portrait of Sinque, the leader of the Amistad uprising. Purvis told him the story of the insurrection on the ship, the trial in American courts, and the verdict that set all the mutineers free. 50 years later, recalling the visit, Purvis said that he drank in every word and greatly admired the hero's courage and intelligence. That night, Washington also knew, from earlier conversation with several of the ship's mates, that the Creole was out of U.S. waters and near the Bahamas. At that moment, far from the state of Florida, he and his companions were legally free. He was certain of that because when he was put on the boat, he shrewdly asked to be made the cook for the slaves. He made food on the deck of the ship and, with assistance, served it to his 134 fellow men and women in bondage. As the cook, he also struck up numerous conversations with the mates and other members of the crew with whom he had become friendly. They good-naturedly kept him apprised of where the brig was as it moved down the Florida coast. They had great confidence in him as a cook and saw him as a reliable person on deck. They never suspected his real motive. In the same way, plantation owners on land often overlooked the motives of slaves entrusted with important jobs. During all those hours as a cook, he also learned how many crew members were on deck in each shift, where they stood, who actually sailed the ship, when their shifts began and ended, what time the captain retired, and where the few guns on the Creole were stored. He kept all this information in his head. Washington may have met some of the slaves on the ship prior to its sailing, when he was kept in the dank, dirty slave pens. He had not known the other slaves held there with him. They were from other plantations in Virginia, or had been dock or factory workers in the city. On board the Creole, he had a chance to scrutinize different slaves, and he picked out those he thought could help him in the mutiny. These were men who were strong, worked hard, were agile, could move rapidly, fought well, and most importantly, wanted to break free, risking their lives if need be to accomplish that goal. Washington could not have done all that if he were down below in the hold. Many of the men he recruited for the takeover.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.